Hello, my name is Ben Schijvers. I'm a senior specialist artist at Guerrilla Games in Amsterdam. For Horizon Zero Dawn, we've used Houdini to create most of the river and lake tools using the Houdini plugin inside of Maya to allow the environment artist to create and modify the rivers. I've also built a system for the environment art to make a blend between the ice effects in the metal world. We've also used Houdini to do prototyping for the clouds. We did the placement of water splashes in the rivers. We had a texture-based vertex animation system for the crowds and the robots in the distance. The cables, the lightning and the hacking. Let's take a closer look at the rivers now. I've been playing with Houdini 16 and the height fields, and I'm trying to get it working with some core principles of the river tool. I'm going to show you how that's built. So what we see here is the end result, which is a river through a terrain, and I'm going to show you how to build something like this. What we do is we start with a curve. Well, we start with the terrain, obviously. We've got the terrain coming in here. And then we start with a curve so we can tell where we want the river to be. Like, it's not in games, it's not necessarily always that you want it on the exact natural location, but you want the river there where the gameplay makes sense. You want to swim somewhere, or you want to build a boundary for the player to cross. So you want the full control, but you want to make it look natural. So the control is the curve, and the natural look comes from Houdini. First thing I'm going to do here is in this node is sample the terrain. So if I could switch on the ghost to terrain a little bit. So the curve snaps onto the terrain. I've resampled the curve beforehand, so it has more resolution. So there's a lot of points here. Each point samples the terrain. I can dive inside, show you that it's not a real difficult thing. There's a node here that samples the volume from the second input. So that's the terrain. And I'm just sampling the height, and the height goes into the vertical component of the position, feeding the position back. And here I'm also sampling the gradient of the terrain, which I can build a normal from, which I had to figure this out a little bit, but it's the, and this has to be woken up. Oh, tell side effects that they fixed that. Yeah, so it had to be negated because of probably the sine distance field on the height field is inverted, and I add some vertical axis because it's a flat, still a flat volume. But this gave me the correct normal. So this node is now giving me the position and the normal of the terrain. Now what I'm going to do is show you what this does, the end of this little for loop. It slices the terrain. And it slices it based on the amount of iterations. So when I move this down, you will see it will look more like the incoming curve. And if I up the iterations, it will slide down. It slides down a little bit too much. You can see on top, the river goes a bit further. So 60 is a nice way. It's a nice value. And this gives already a more natural look than the input curve. So what I do is I sample the terrain here, and this one is sliding it sideways. It's just one little step. In the end, I will start at the end, it's multiplied by 25, so it's not making a huge step each iteration. So it's like 60 times 25 centimeters. So it's taking little steps to progress through the terrain. The start here is that I take the previous point position
and the current point position and I subtract them. So I get a vector along the curve. I normalize the vector and it goes into this little subnetwork, which is, can ignore the stuff on the bottom. It's doing a cross product on that curve, on the vector, I mean, of the curve and on itself. And this gives me a vector that's on the surface of the terrain, pointing sideways, and it's sliding down. I add that to the point position, so I get this little displacement going on there. After that, I resample it. That's always good to sort of get rid of weird things. I can probably turn this off. It's not, yeah, you can see sort of that points will move apart and resampling it will make sure that we keep that same sort of look. Now, but you can't see here too well, but I can visualize it with this little side network here, is that the river actually goes upstream. So it goes up a mountain and then goes down again. That is, water would never do that. Water doesn't stream uphill, it only streams downhill. So actually, we're actually looking at it already. I made a note that sort of prevents water from flowing uphill. It's only allowed to go down. To do that, I'm looping through the points one by one in the order of the curve. And I'm can show you the code. It's actually not so hard, but this is one of the things I did in Python. Because Python allows me an easy way to loop through the points in the order of the curve. I take a minimum height and I set that height each iteration, so each point, to the minimum. So that means that, so this is the core function of it. It means that the river will never go higher, it will only go lower. And that's exactly what I want. There's another bit here that does the reverse, and that's more for some other cases I won't show now. So that means that we have a little, well, I can better show it from another angle. So rather than going over the hill, it goes through the hill. It cuts a little canyon. So I could go back and move my curve around. And I could sort of move it through other bits. Let's see here, for instance. I can make it cut through this thing there. So now it makes a real big canyon because I force it to go uphill. Let's make it a bit wider so it makes a nice thing. So you can see that the river reacts on those little hills here. That's a nice example of it sort of automatically picks a nice location to make it look natural. Yeah, so we got already a river now that sort of goes only downwards. That's a rule. So like the people who put the rivers there, they don't need to worry about it too much. They of course have to make it look natural so they can't cut through everything, but at least this tool helps with it. So the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to show you this one. Next thing I'm going to do is like create the width of the river. Let's switch off these things. Let's switch off the terrain itself because we believe how that looks. So I'm using copy SOP to copy little line there. So just a simple line with 8 points. And copy the line on the river. So to do that, I'm using the normal and the up vector to align the cross section. and I'm calculating that in here together with the width. And I'm using the scale to do that. So I'm using a normal for the alignment and the up vector. And the scale sets the size. So that gives me the way to control the width. Now this is a bit more complicated, but not so much. The bit here is doing the alignment. The up vector is just pointing up. And the normal is just along the curve. So I'll take the previous point again. So take the point number, I subtract one, and I read the position of the previous points. That gives me a vector along the curve. You can also use the body frame to do this, but since I was in this node, I choose to do it here. To get it a bit more smoother, because if I use this smooth node on the normal, this one will give me a bit more parallel cross sections, else you get this, and this will be a bit harder to control the look of the river. So I do it like this, and then they still have those areas there, but that's not so, it's not a big problem, but else it would be everywhere. So I'm smoothing the normal attribute that will smooth my cross-section alignment. The river width is then controlled by three things. First, it's a ramp parameter, the one over here. And you can see it here. I can just modify the width here. Just so this is more like artist control. Sort of what we had for like Horizon as well. Although we had some more controls to control width at certain local areas. Go back to the inside. The other modification that we do to width, so it's basically a multiply. So we have a scale factor on top of this ramp, is looking at the slope. So the more the river goes downhill, the more narrow it is, and then if it hits a more flat area, it goes wider. And if you have a little cascade, then it also goes like narrow. So you see it here, it goes down, and it's more narrow there to give it a more natural look. So what we do is like we measure the slope of the terrain. So we compare the vertical components that we get here by the length of the horizontal components. And that gives us a certain value that we use to scale the cross-section width. I do a power curve here. If you set this to 1, then slope is, yeah, it's not the right look for this thing. So we do it like this, so we get more narrow sections. There's more contrast. You could call it contrast, but it's it's something else. It's a power curve. The other thing that I use to set the width is to use that sort of canyon value, the canyon depth. So here we cut through the terrain in this section, and that sort of controls how much the thing scales. So we scale it by half. If it goes 10 meters deep, the canyon, then the width will be halved. So the river will be more narrow in the canyon. So all that is coming out as like scale, which is a three-dimensional vector. So I had to build it up here. That's some defaults value, so don't look at that. All that comes out and it gives me a river width. Now the next step will be to build, because it's still a flat profile, so we have to give the river some depth. So what I do here is something that people probably not do often. It's like, now it looks like it's doing it, but I'm actually not creating a real skin. I'm actually creating curves again. So I set this to columns, but default is cotyledons. Then you create an actual surface, but I was after the curves, so I could treat them differently. So I could grab the outside edges, so let's do that straight away, and project them on the terrain again, using the same trick by sampling the volume straight away the volume, which is really quick. So that works really well. Outside edges sample the terrain, and the inside edges, I've just selected them manually, like number 3 and 4. Can we really see it? They go down a little bit. If you skin this again, you got, let's view the normal, so they're a bit nicer. You can see that we now got a better profile. And this is actually already good enough to bring into bring back into the height field. I'll switch off the coset object. So this will be almost usable in a game. I'll show you what I've done here. Also not so hard. This is, let's start at the end. The height comes out again. And here there's a two-way switch. It switches between the incoming height and this one. And this is me doing a intersect with that geometry that comes into the second input. What I first do is I set the ray origin and I take the point position, move it down, and then I'm raying it up again. Means that I'm sending rays from the bottom up to hit that geometry. And I could do it from the top, but then those little things that go a little bit wrong at the edge where the river overlaps itself, that's fixed by this. It's like doing a minimum function if you send the rays from the bottom, because it's the first surface it hits will be used. Show you this little bit later. So to display the end result a little better, or we could do this. I've built a water surface here, but this network is not so interesting, so skip that. So you can see that you have water. We can also see this looks a bit synthetic, like these straight lines, and that's not so good. So what I've done is I've already built a little network that does the following. It will add some noise to that terrain. How this is done is doing by, I take the input mesh. Now let's switch on the wireframe again. I don't know the shortcut for that. It's probably W something. Uppress and add noise. It's very simple. It's a mountain node that's really useful for adding noise to terrain. Let's look how this is looking now. So that's, you can switch this on and off. So you see this is a way better looking thing. But now we have these sharp edges. So for that I figured out I need some sort of way to fade out the new terrain. So I've added an alpha channel here. So show you the, oh, now I can better show you this. So it's adding alpha as a point attribute to the mesh. And here I've got the option to sample the point attributes. And that's where this little network is for. So if I now switch on this, I can show that it's fixing those edges. It also shows that you can sample a lot more from the geometry. So it's not only the height, but you can actually get your point attributes there. So I've used the intersect here, because the intersect not only gives me the value, but it also gives me the primitive number, and it gives me the UV coordinates of the polygon it has hit on that intersect function. This node just is a one that will interpolate the point attribute at a certain UV coordinate of a certain primitive. I use a little smooth function to have a little narrow blend over area, and that's used in the mix. So the mix is again mixing between the original height and the height coming in from the intersect function. So this gives me a more noisified water look, which is way better. For Horizon Zero Dawn, I've actually not used this noise. What I've done is like I'm sampling the terrain and let it slide down the terrain. I've also done that for the edges, so the edges also are noisified by the terrain itself, rather than using a noise. I liked it a lot more than using noise, because like there's a lot of noise in the terrain, and to use the user terrain itself, it gets integrated better. The last step that we've done to make the rivers look a little bit more realistic is, let's see an area where this comes. Well, let's find out. Is that I've built in some sort of cascading feature. Switch it on for the water at the same time. Yes, so you can see it here. I'll explain what I'm doing. Rather than having the water slide down in one continuous go, smooth slope, we've done this in steps. This is more like how water would react. It would be like a few rocks here, the water would accumulate here and get a little reservoir, and water would widen and then go through this little cascade area. And we would dress this up with particles in the game, because that's how it would naturally look. So here you can see the canyon. And so here we've got a finished sort of water look. Although eventually in the game, and if you want to make this into a tool, it will be way more complex. It will be gameplay things like the water depth, and like the slopes of the edges should be at a certain angle so people can climb in or out of the water. You want to be able to control all these things.
So that was just the core principles of the river tool. I will now show you how the tool that we use for production looks. It has a lot more controls, as you can see. There are even some localized controls. You can switch one on, and you can see that I can change various attributes on a local scale, like the width and the river depth. And in Maya, the tool looks pretty similar. All the parameters are automatically generated, and they give the artist a lot of control. Like I'm showing here is the meandering, for instance, that can be controlled. And there's like water levels that can be set in the context of traversal. And same for the edges, so the player can get out of the water or out of the riverbed in an easy way. All these rivers are made one by one, and they end up on disk and then are loaded in and by a tile generator that will create the tiles for the game, and that will go further into the pipeline and eventually end up in the game and to form one continuous water surface.
name is Vladimir Lopatin. I'm a senior specialist artist at Guerrilla Games. We've just finished the production of Horizon Zero Dawn. During the production of Horizon Zero Dawn, we used Houdini for small general pipeline tools for the artists, such as cable tools, Previz for generating various patterns, such as robot brain patterns, electricity and lightning effects. In this tutorial, I would like to take you through the process, showing how we generated cables for our game. The process involves a few stages. First, generating the cable geometry suitable for simulation. Second, using a finite element solver to get the sense of realism to the cables. And the third is deforming cable geometry in such a way that it doesn't lead to artifacts.
Here I'm going to explain how the cables were generated in a state necessary before we can run the simulation on top of them. It was important to have cables non-intersecting each other. So they had to be generated in such a way that would guarantee that there is no interpenetrations. In order to achieve that, I have taken the bounding box of the original mock-up geometry. I have turned it into a volume. I scattered point clouds and then applied tetrahedralized node to create a tetrahedralized point cloud, effectively. That is fairly, as far as I can tell, basic setup for any path searching algorithm which based around edges. So this tetrahedralized point cloud is a base for path searching algorithm to construct paths from set of root points to the endpoints. I do some filtering which removes unnecessary edges, since the tetrahedralized node does introduce, it effectively connects every point with every other point. Some of the edges are rather long, which we don't need want. And I'm deleting the longest edges just based on the certain absolute value, based on the perimeter, which gives us the length of every edge. I'm constructing a set of attributes necessary to drive the path searching algorithm. I'm choosing a set of points as our starting points, the root points. I'm introducing some noise to noisify the initial locations for the path searching algorithm, and have a control for later takes if I need to generate more cables. So in order to generate cables in such a way that they don't intersect, I'm using Subsolver, which constructs a cable by cable, step by step. And that's the nature of a Subsolver, which is rather handy for this particular task. I will not go too much into the details of what is going on over here. Subsolver is notoriously tricky to debug without extracting part of the networks elsewhere. But essentially what is going on here is that we're using a path searching algorithm to construct a path through from the root points to the endpoints, and convert the such cable into a mesh, which becomes a bounding object for bounding object which selects points in the original point cloud, and we delete those points. Therefore, every cable, by growing through this point cloud, selects a set of cables which it occupies, and these cables get extracted from the input mesh. So now we end up with a point cloud which has part of it extracted, and that part is our first cable. So the second cable will be generated through the point cloud, which has this first cable points extracted. Therefore, it cannot grow through the space occupied by the original cable. And that we do step by step. So every cable selects points, extracts them from the original point cloud, and passes this changed point cloud for the next step, for the next iteration of the subsolver. We do it step by step, as many times as we have cables. In this case, there are 131 cables, but you can see how it's going on in the process. So we generate all the cables in this fashion. This is the final look of this step, of this process. And we just need to clean up, get rid of the points which are not cables. Essentially, we kill all the points which are the original point cloud, and we only end up with the splines generated by the path searching algorithm. We use this. We could use these splines to, after a certain cleanup, reduce getting rid of the old little bits. As you can see, there is little bits which we're not interested in. We get rid of them just based on length. We turn them into the polywire, and that's how we get our cables, which are ready for the simulation. And this set of cables is guaranteed not to intersect. This is rather good for finite element solver.